The Asus ROG Ally is using AMD's latest 4nm APU, combining Zen 4 CPU cores with their RDNA 3 GPU. There's no doubt about it, it's a much more powerful chip than the APU inside the Steam Deck. But benchmarks show that the ROG Ally struggles to keep up with the Steam Deck when running at power-optimized TDP settings. How is it possible that a objectively more powerful and more advanced chip is delivering worse performance? To figure that out, let's take a closer look at the chips inside the ROG Ally and the Steam Deck to see what's actually going on at the silicon level. Looking at the raw specs, the performance gap between the Ally and the Steam Deck cannot be overstated. We are literally talking about multiple generational leaps. The Steam Deck uses a 4-core 8-thread Zen 2 CPU clocked at up to 3.5 GHz, while the Ally has a 8-core 16-thread Zen 4 CPU at up to 5.1 GHz. A massive jump in CPU performance. The GPU isn't any less impressive. While the Steam Deck uses a older RDNA 2 based GPU with 8 compute units and up to 1.6 teraflops, the ROG Ally is powered by a 12 compute unit RDNA 3 GPU with a theoretical maximum of 8.6 teraflops. That's over 5 times the potential graphics performance. Regarding memory, the Ally also has the upper hand with low power DDR5 6400. With this massive difference in specs, there is no way the Steam Deck should be able to come close or even compete with the Ally. Yet looking at benchmarks, we get a lot of results that look like that. The Steam Deck comfortably outperforming the ROG Ally. To get to the bottom of this, we have to take a look at the physical chips next. The ROG Ally uses a Ryzen Z1 Extreme branded APU. There's also a non-extreme version with a 6-core CPU and only 4 compute units, but that won't release until later this year and all current benchmarks are based on the Extreme variant. The Ryzen Z1 Extreme is an interesting APU, combining AMD's most recent architectures into one monolithic chip with 24 megabytes of total L2 and L3 cache. The physical chip itself contains around 25 billion transistors on a 178mm² die produced in TSMC's N4 process node, which is an optimized 5nm variant. But despite the brand new name, we are not looking at a new product. As you can clearly see when comparing the Z1 Extreme to the Ryzen 7 7840U, AMD's latest notebook APU, codenamed Phoenix. They are the same chip. What Asus has done here is take AMD's latest low-power laptop APU, add a few tweaks here and there, change the name to Ryzen Z1 series, and done is the ROG Ally gaming APU. But is this a bad thing? Phoenix is the latest and greatest available on the market right now. It's not like Asus could design a better chip, right? So how come it struggles with the Steam Deck? Not only chips are getting more complex, the same is true for cybersecurity. Today, businesses are especially vulnerable. All it needs is a single employee with a bad password. That's where today's sponsor, NordPass Business, comes in. NordPass Business manages and protects your company's digital assets by solving one of the biggest and also most tedious problems for any company, password security. The password manager makes sure that every single account is using strong passwords, and at the same time it simplifies password-related tasks from onboarding new employees and resetting passwords to sharing and revoking access. If you have worked in IT before, you know how much time is spent on these simple password-related tasks. NordPass Business also gives you valuable data insights over access and activities and notifies you about data breaches. For me, the value proposition of a password manager, be it for private or business use, is that you are maximizing both your security and convenience at the same time. It's no longer a trade-off between using secure, unique passwords and spending a lot of time managing them. Make the first step now and see NordPass Business in action, completely risk-free with a 3-month free trial. Go to nordpass.com/highyieldbusiness or click the link in the description below. With that, let's get back to the transistor level. The most important difference between the Van Gogh APU inside the deck and the Phoenix APU inside the Ally isn't visible when looking at the specs, but it is visible with the naked eye. And no, I don't mean the size of the chip. Here's a picture from Linus Tech Tips that shows the inside of the Steam Deck. Can you spot the important part? It's the huge Valve logo on the chip itself, with only a small powered by AMD below it. This branding is not due to the vanity of Gabe Newell. It's a clear sign that we are looking at an actual fully custom chip. This is not an AMD chip. AMD just helped Valve create it. And the only product it is used for is the Steam Deck, which it was specifically designed for. When Valve created the Van Gogh APU, it had a single focus: achieve playable gaming performance at ultra low power, which is very different to what Phoenix was designed for, being a general purpose laptop APU. Designing a fully custom chip allows for drastic changes to its core functions, to an extent most people underestimate. Even though the chip inside a Steam Deck is smaller and older than the chip powering the ROG Ally, Valve most likely did spend a lot more money on it, because designing a custom chip is very expensive, from the extended engineering work to the product specific tape out. To uncover the impact a fully custom chip can have, we have to look at the silicon level. There aren't any die shots of Van Gogh, Valve is good at keeping secrets, but it's closely related to AMD's Renoir APU, which we will use as a basis for our analysis. Renoir has 8 Zen 2 CPU cores, split into 2 4-core CCX clusters, but it still uses a Vega-based iGPU. You can also see the large amount of physical I/O ports marked with red. All these also use up transistor and power budget. When you imagine Van Gogh as Renoir with one less Zen 2 CCX and a larger Ardyn 2-based GPU, you suddenly realize its focus on GPU area, as the GPU is the most important piece of hardware for PC gaming. This mockup isn't trying to be an accurate representation of the actual chip, it's more to emphasize the impact of its custom design. Valve deliberately chose a small and less powerful 4-core Zen 2 CCX for transistor and power budget reasons. If you want to run your APU at ultra low TDP levels, you already know you won't have enough power budget to fire up 8 CPU cores, and if you did, there wouldn't be any power left to run the GPU. With a custom chip, Valve designed an APU that provides the perfect balance between CPU and GPU, not from a general point of view, but from the edge case of only having a few watts of power available. But an APU is much more than just its CPU and GPU cores. It also contains a memory controller, input-output units, and much more. All these areas are often overlooked, but when you run a chip at power levels at or below 10 watts, they quickly become important factors. When the Steam Deck launched, I was a bit disappointed that it was only using low power DDR5 5500 and not the faster 6400 transfer rates. But now I understand that it both saves energy on the memory modules and the memory controller inside the APU, reducing its energy consumption. Bandwidth is important for GPU performance, but if you don't have any energy left to power your GPU cores because you spend it all on the memory controller to run at 6400 speeds, it doesn't matter how much bandwidth you have. At ultra low power, the entire GPU bandwidth calculation changes, because every watt spent on the GPU cores itself is more impactful. If we compare Van Gogh to Phoenix, the chip used by the ROG Ally, we can see a completely different focus. Phoenix is foremost a high-end CPU with its 8-core 16-thread Zen 4 CPU cluster. Even in a desktop environment, it would deliver high-end CPU performance. The iGPU, while powerful, is more of an afterthought since gaming laptops are using dedicated GPUs. Phoenix also has a large new AI engine, although it has been deactivated for the Z1 branded chips, one of the small tweaks Asus made. A great example of this different philosophy is also visible in the use of PCI Express technology for the M2 SSD. Both the Steam Deck and the ROG Ally use PCI Express, but the Steam Deck only supports PCI Express Gen 3, while the Ally uses Gen 4. At first glance, it's not that big of a difference, but I'm sure you have heard about how hot and power-hungry PCIe 4.0 connections can be. For a chip that's supposed to run at 15 to 45 watts, Gen 4 is the clear choice, offering a more modern and faster connection. But the PCI Express controller is located inside of the APU itself, and when you are designing a chip that's supposed to be fully functional with as little as 4 watts, every bit of energy counts. The same is true for the display outputs or USB connections. AMD's Phoenix offers plenty of connectivity to satisfy the needs of the modern laptop users. Van Gogh, on the other hand, most likely has as little I/O as possible in order to reduce transistor and energy spending. I can't imagine Valve fitting their custom chip with an extensive selection of I/O that the Steam Deck doesn't even provide physical ports for. In addition, the voltage curve of Van Gogh might not be optimized for best overall efficiency, but for lowest power consumption. If you have the choice between 100% performance at 10 watts and, let's say, 250% performance at 20 watts, you would probably choose the latter, as it has higher efficiency overall. But if your goal is long battery life, it suddenly looks different. All these small improvements Valve implemented into Van Gogh, like the removal of unnecessary I/O, reduced clock speeds for the memory controller, PCI Express Gen 3 for the M2 SSD, a larger focus on GPU over CPU and so on are not contributing much on their own, but combined they create a chip that, when used at ultra low power, has a huge advantage. Another great way to visualize the difference between the chips inside the ROG Ally and the Steam Deck is to compare the TDP ranges they were originally designed for. When Go has an operational range between 4 and 15 watts, and not just on paper, that's what it was designed for from the ground up. Running the Steam Deck APU at 15 watts is already maxing it out. It's most certainly not the sweet spot. AMD's Phoenix APU, on the other hand, was designed with the Ryzen 7 40 series in mind that consists of U and HS labeled CPUs, ranging from 15 to 45 watts, some parts even reaching 54 watts. Yes, the Z1 Extreme has a TDP range of 9 to 30 watts, but that's just a software-based TDP limitation. The Phoenix chip it is based on was not designed to run it below 15 watts. 15 watts was supposed to be the absolute lower limit. Once you realize the very different power levels these chips are designed for, it becomes clear that although the Steam Deck and the ROG Ally look very similar and promise the same handheld gaming experience, at their core they are very different product tiers. The Ally uses an all-purpose, off-the-shelf laptop APU, the Deck has a handcrafted chip purpose-built for ultra-low power. All of the design differences we just talked about directly impact performance, as we can see in the benchmarks. Fellow YouTuber The Fox did some really interesting benchmark runs at different TDP levels, starting from 5 watts and going all the way to 20 watts and beyond. He has quite a few amazing videos on this topic, and I highly recommend checking out his channel if you are interested in in-depth benchmarks of the ROG Ally and the Steam Deck. In his videos, he observes the same as many others did. At 10 watts or below, the Steam Deck outperforms the ROG Ally, but at 15 watts or above, it's the other way around. And with the knowledge about the customizing efforts for the Steam Deck APU, all of this suddenly makes sense. Even if the Ryzen Z1 Extreme uses just an extra 2-3 watts on all the features that got optimized with the Steam Deck APU, at 5 watts total TDP, these 2-3 watts account for 40-60% of the entire power budget. At that point, it doesn't matter how much more advanced the Phoenix APU is. It just lacks a choice to power its CPU and GPU cores and compete with the Steam Deck. The result is that the Steam Deck handily outperforms the ROG Ally. Not because it has a more modern architecture or more CPU and GPU cores, but because it's actually able to power its CPU and GPU cores in a meaningful way at these low TDP levels, made possible by the amazing customizing efforts from Valve. While the ROG Ally is too starved to properly function. At 10 watts TDP, 2-3 watts still account for a 20-30% difference. That's why the Deck is still able to keep up. But at 15 watts and above, the improved architecture and process node of the ROG Ally start to make up for the lack of ultra-low power customization. Now that you know why each handheld behaves the way it does, there are two questions left. Which one is better, and what can we expect for the future of handhelds? The first question is pretty easy to answer. If you want a handheld gaming console for prolonged mobile gameplay, the Steam Deck still reigns supreme. Keep in mind that the Deck isn't known for its long battery life, but if you want to run games at below 10 watts, which should be your goal if you aim for long battery life, the Van Gogh APU outclasses Phoenix. Not because it's better in of itself, but because it's a much more specialized chip. And since both consoles have the same 40 watt hour battery, the Steam Deck just runs longer. Plus, Valve SteamOS also slightly increases battery life, since it's more lightweight than Windows. But if battery life isn't your primary goal, the ROG Ally offers a much more powerful system, with the capabilities of running modern games in 1080p resolution, sometimes even at medium settings and high frame rates, in the palm of your hand. It might be only for a short hour or so, but for a daily commute or as a portable desktop replacement, it just does more for you. If you allow it to draw the power it needs to fire up its engine, it wipes the floor with the Steam Deck. And then there are cool use cases like emulation, where the Zen 4 CPU with its AVX 512 support delivers great performance while staying below 10 watts. For me, ROG Ally and Steam Deck, despite their similar looks, target different use cases. If you're aware of that, you know which system to choose. All of this makes me excited for the future. Just imagine how amazing a true custom chip based on the current gen Phoenix technology would be. Optimized for around 10 watts, it could almost double the performance of the Steam Deck at the same power level. With the immense success of the Steam Deck, I'm sure Valve is already working on a Steam Deck too. And if we get another custom chip like with Van Gogh, I can't wait to see what it will do for mobile gaming. Now I would like to know your opinion on the whole ROG Ally versus Steam Deck situation. Which handheld would you choose and why? Did you expect that the Steam Deck could actually beat the Ally at 10 watts or below? And how would your perfect next-gen Steam Deck look like? Leave a comment down below, I'm looking forward to your input. Thanks again to NordPass Business for sponsoring this video. Click the link below to find out more. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, you know what to do, and see you in the next one.